Let's stop and think about this. This 15-story section in the North Tower begins suddenly, without warning, smoothly and symmetrically diving straight down toward its own footprint. And this can't happen unless, as Richard said, all these core columns, at least, are severed. And in fact, this upper story section, this 15-story section, is destroying itself. In 4 seconds, it is completely gone. After that, there is nothing to crush the rest of the building below it in any of the photographs or the videos. In fact, the rest of the building is destroying itself, and it turns out to be at two-thirds of free fall acceleration, accelerating almost as fast as the debris falling alongside it.
All right, Richard Gage, hold on. Ron Craig in studio. Stay put. I'll let you respond to Richard there, Ron. And we'll, as I say, get to calls towards the latter stages of the program. Just sit back and take it all in as we debate civilly, respectfully. And this doesn't happen a whole lot in the media, but we do it here as a matter of course. What brought down the Twin Tower buildings on 9/11? My name is Richard Serrett.
Fasten your seatbelt and put your tray in the upright position. You're about to leave everything you know behind. On The Conspiracy Show with Richard Serrett from Zoomer Radio, AM 740.
Richard Gage on the phone, San Francisco Bay Area architect, member of the American Institute of Architects and founder of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth, Ron Craig in studio, the International Society of Explosives Engineers, and also an experienced special effects supervisor with over 25 years experience, however. Notwithstanding, he says that what we saw happen on 9/11 was not sleight of hand or an illusion. There was no advanced explosives planted in those buildings. Richard Gage, of course, would beg to differ. Now, I want Ron to respond to what you said earlier, Richard, and it was in response to my original question, and that is what appeared to be a very symmetrical fall of the or descent of the building. And again, I'm not quite clear how it is that you could have something like that unless all of the core columns failed at precisely the same time. And I think a lot of people would have trouble wrapping their heads around how that could happen.
Well, first of all, I want to rebut what Richard has said about buildings and free fall speeds, and it hasn't happened, it doesn't happen. I'd like all of the listeners to go to YouTube and punch in the Delft University building in Denmark. It was a very significant fire that took place inside the library building itself, and there was very little flame seen for a number of hours. In other words, it had burned for a number of hours, and suddenly, without warning, the entire building collapsed. And if you look at it, it descends in exactly the same pattern, the same way as we saw with buildings 1 and 2, although on a smaller scale. So to say that it doesn't happen is totally technically incorrect. It does happen.
Well, the building did not totally collapse. It was simply a partial collapse, and there was plenty of warning. There were large, gradual deformations, which we would expect in any destruction due to fire, because it's an organic process that moves through a building every 20 minutes or so.
Actually, there were no deformations. There were no deformations. The building suddenly collapsed. And if you look at it, you see explosive squibs come out from the building that look identical to the squibs that came out of Building 1 and 2, according to you. And also, Richard, if I may make the point, if you actually look at the footage, you can see that there's very little fire inside the building, which is one of the claims that's made in your slideshow, which is there's very little fire inside the building. Why did it collapse? So if you look at that as an example, you find out that, in fact, your case is significantly weakened.
Let's see. The fires in the South Tower, after only 56 minutes, were going out, evidenced by the black smoke. They were oxygen-starved and cool. And compare that to fires that have lasted up to 17, 24 hours, burning over many, many floors. No steel frame high rise has ever collapsed due to fire, and yet we have three on 9/11, and we'll get to Building 7, which wasn't hit by an airplane. But relative to the Twin Towers, these were relatively small fires. And the fire is irrelevant, actually, because what we see is the evidence for explosive demolition. Let's discuss. That we have sudden bands of explosions wrapping around the building, described by up to 100 firefighters and first responders, recorded on audio tape that we didn't even know about until August of 2005, and that wasn't included in any of the official reports. They're describing flashes of light at the onset of this destruction on several floors. They're describing bands of explosions, pop, 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 and then debris started flying everywhere. In fact, that debris is flying at an instant acceleration of 50 to 70 miles per hour and lands 600 feet away from the building. The physics of this suggests that they can only be propelled by explosives.
Well, first of all, you're getting two things confused here in the argument. So let's deal with each of them separately and logically. Let's deal with the fire. I've heard in your slideshow, and I've also heard other speakers say, it was a very lazy fire inside World Trade Center Building 1 and 2 because we could see black smoke, which indicates that it was in its latter stages and the fire had essentially gone out. And that's not correct. When you see black smoke, it can be indicative of that, but it also can be indicative of a very hot hydrocarbon fire. And by hydrocarbon, I don't mean the fuel from the plane. I'm talking about plastics that burn. In fact, if you go to the, some of the literature that's done on fire engineering, you will find that office fires are actually hotter than house fires, that in fact they're very significant, and we have to understand those fire loads. So that's the first point I want to make. The second point is, an explosive, when it goes off and changes from a solid to a gas almost instantly, creating heat and pressure, does so with a very specific signature. People can say, I heard cracks and bangs. I would expect that if a building was going to collapse and was in the process of collapsing. But that does not mean that it was explosives. The signatures that came from that building were absolutely not explosive signatures. There's no way that you could say that they were explosive signatures, except if you were wishing they were, and there were no explosives used.
Regarding the fires, we have Chief Oreo Palmer in the 78th floor saying there's two isolated pockets of fire. This is where the airplane impacted. They were out. 10 minutes later, the explosions began. Now, they wouldn't be seeing flashes of light associated with the sounds of explosions, associated with the visual bands of explosions forcing debris out of the side, every side of the World Trade Center towers, if they weren't explosions.
Well, first of all, if we are talking about explosions knocking out all of the beams, is that what you're claiming, that all of the core beams would be knocked out and that would precipitate the collapse? Is that your argument, Richard?
What else could cause the building to suddenly, 1 second after it's still, descend symmetrically, smoothly, suddenly, and accelerating without any jolt or impact? There is no stopping of this building when it meets the other building. The only way that could happen is if, in fact, those core columns were removed. And that's just the plain common sense of it, even without all the other massive evidence for explosions, such as you mentioned, the squibs going off 10, 20, 40, even 60 stories down below this canopy of violent destruction.
Let's talk about those squibs.
Isolated jets are coming out of the building at 160 to 200 feet per second.
Let's talk about those squibs, because for many people, that is a signature of a controlled demolition. Explain, first of all, Ron, why those squibs that, and we've seen them in the videos and the stills, why that wouldn't necessarily be, in your mind, the signature of a controlled demolition.
Again, I want people to go and punch into YouTube the Delft building, and just before the collapse starts, look at the explosive squibs that take place just below the collapse line, and they look identical to the squibs that came out of World Trade Center Building 1 and 2.
What causes
them? The fire in the Delft building was started, by the way, because a water pipe busted and flooded a coffee maker, which started a fire, which spread very quickly and ended up burning the entire building to the point where, as Richard has pointed out, the point where the fire was concentrated, the building actually collapsed. What causes squibs is as a building is coming down, air is being compressed and forced through ducts, through openings, and as a result, it comes out as dust. That's seen in all types of buildings that collapse when firefighters are there and they're looking at them. But to us, we haven't seen them before, so we immediately attribute them to explosives.
Well,
I want to go back to the...
Richard,
I want to go back to the 47...
First, let's...
The floor plan of the building.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because...